Helping students and healthcare professionals not just survive, but thrive with a purpose. This is the CMDA Student Pulse Podcast with your host, Bill Reichart, National Director of CMDA Campus Ministries.
Well, welcome to another episode of CMDA's Student Pulse Podcast. I'm Bill Reichart, National Director of Campus and Community Ministries here at CMDA. And my guest today is Dr. Marco Britton. Dr. Britton, thanks for being a part of the podcast.
Thank you for inviting me to be part of the broadcast. The broadcast.
It's all right. Listen, we just had a chance to see each other at the National Convention, and that was a real pleasure to see you and your friend and the work you're doing. I trust it was a blessing for you to be a part of that. That was your first National Convention there in Cincinnati, wasn't it?
It was, and it was a tremendous blessing to be there, just to connect with the different individuals that I've met and speak with them and kind of learn what some of the things they were doing as well. And it was a really good convention, and I was blessed to be there. Mm,
fantastic. Well, let's do this. Obviously we know each other, but let me introduce you to our listening or viewing audience. Dr. Marco Britton is a board-certified physician who practices in Dallas-Fort Worth as corporate medical director. His specialty is occupational medicine. You also have a practice in or have experience practicing primary care and urgent care. In addition, Marco is a devout Christian, loving family man, entrepreneur, and more. And you are, Marco, the CEO and founder of Total Success 365, which is a Christian-based personal development brand that specializes in helping individuals achieve success in all major areas of life, faith, family, fitness, and finances. And we're going to touch on that some too. But okay. So, you know, you're talking about success in these areas, and you're coaching other folks. And I've read your bio, and you know, one might think, Marco, you just have this charm life. You know, I know you have a beautiful family and just a wonderful practice and work that God's called you to. But let's just make sure people understand your story a little bit. What is your personal story leading up to a moment like this? What's your background? Tell us a little bit about some of the challenges you faced growing up.
Okay. I'll start with, I guess, part of what you were talking about. Success. When the reason why I even started Total Success 365 is the fact that people, you know, when they meet me or they find out that I'm a physician, because I don't go around telling everyone. There's people I've been in contact with for years, and they find out, you know, a couple years after the fact that, you're a physician, and they don't believe it because I don't act like a physician. Okay. All the time.
All right. We'll have to explore what that means, but go ahead.
And so, but one of the things that those people say all the time is that, you know, once they find out, oh, you're successful because you're a physician, you're successful because you know, they assume I have money, or you're successful because you have a business, you're successful because whatever. Right. And for me, you know, success is much more, much deeper than finances and career. And I know a lot of this generation, the younger generation, the millennials and Gen Zs, and even Gen X, which is the generation I'm a part of, you know, they're so focused on the financial aspect of success that they forget there are other types of success. Those include, for us, like you said, faith, family, fitness, finances. And so I'll pause there on that, and I'll answer your question. Your question is my background. Mm. So I'm a physician now, and people think that I'm successful because I'm a physician. But my background starts in what we call the hood, the ghetto. Back in the day, people called the projects of Decatur, Illinois. I was born in the late 70s. And I know I don't look like I'm as old as I am, but I am. People always tell me that. But I was born... I had to throw that in there. Okay. As you can tell, I like to joke and all that stuff too. But born in the late 70s in Decatur, Illinois, in the roughest part of town. It was a neighborhood called Longview. And people, if you're from Decatur, you know what that is. They actually tore it down about 10, 15 years ago. But everything you see from, you know, the movies when it pertains to, you know, those type of neighborhoods, drugs, crime, murders, gangs, all of those things were things that I grew up seeing. And even, you know, grew up in a family that was extended family that was involved in a lot of those things. So I got to see a lot of that up close and personal. And so growing up at that time, which was a time where you had the crack epidemic, AIDS epidemic, just crime epidemics, all those different types of epidemics. And having people that I knew, whether it be family members, friends, that were involved in those things, I shouldn't have ended up where I ended up. I should have been like a lot of my old friends and acquaintances. I should have ended up either dead or prison. But God had another plan for my life. And that plan was for me to be a physician, career-wise. But, you know, in addition to, you know, just, you know, growing up in the area that I grew up in, I, you know, a lot of kids, they got influenced by the older guys in the neighborhood who were doing some of those things. I saw some of the things that they had, and I wanted some of the things, cars, the money, all of that. But I also was a dreamer, and I used to watch a lot of television, and that's a whole nother story. It goes to the fitness part of the 4Fs. Because I sat and watched a lot of TV, I was an overweight kid. I was teased and bullied because of that. But watching television, I was inspired to become a physician. I watched The Cosby Show and Growing Pains and those type of shows. And I saw these physician fathers leading their families. And I wanted to be like them when I grew up. And so that sparked the interest in me as a kid. But from that time to you know, the time I actually became a physician and a family man, there was a lot of things I had to deal with that there were so many obstacles along the way. And I talk about a lot of them in my book. Because right. I know we only have an hour here, or well, 30 minutes, or whatever.
Well, and that is a good place to at least let our listeners and viewers know that, yes, you have documented all this in a book called Gracious Vindication, I think it's called, right?
Yes.
Stay with us. More Student Pulse podcast in just a moment.
As the largest faith-based healthcare professional organization in the world, the Christian Medical and Dental Associations educates, encourages, and equips its more than 13,000 Christian healthcare professionals to care for the poor, homeless, and refugees in some of the most vulnerable areas in America. In addition to providing resources, networking opportunities, education, and a public voice for Christian healthcare professionals and students, the CMDA addresses policies on healthcare issues and conducts overseas medical education. These CMDA members integrate their faith with their practice while serving the poor, uninsured, and underinsured. Learn more today about the Christian Medical and Dental Associations, changing hearts in healthcare. For more information on how to join or donate, go to cmda.org/viewpoint or call 888-230-2637.
And so I know it does seem like a big leap, you know, you're, you know, growing up to a physician, and I know there's a lot of obstacles in between and challenges, but obviously the Lord saw fit, you know, as he was watching over your life to bring you through those on the other end. Obviously it says something about perhaps your character in terms of the resilience and be able to press through those challenges, but maybe speak into this idea of faith. How did you come to a place where you embrace Christ as your Savior? You now are a Christ follower. When did that happen, and how much did that play into being able to press through those obstacles?
Well, to answer your last question, if it hadn't been for my relationship with God, me being a Christ follower, I wouldn't have made it to where I am now. Yeah. But I'll backtrack to the first question. So there's a couple different points in my life where I knew for sure that it was God. God had been pulling at my heartstrings. Age six, I had an experience. I call it an experience now. At the time, I called it a dream, where I was having a dream about something, and I can't remember what the dream was about. But all of a sudden, that dream was gone, and I was standing in this open field by myself. And I just remember as a kid thinking, oh, wow, Mother Nature. Everything was beautiful. And it was like swaying grass. There was pretty blue skies, pretty flowers. And I remember looking over to my right and walking towards an area where there's some trees. And I walked over to, you know, where the trees were. And I remember standing there as a kid and in this, what I thought was a dream. And I remember just standing there, kind of started getting a little afraid, because I was like, what is this? And where am I? And because it seemed so real. It went from being a dream to being in this place that was so real. And I remember, last thing I remember from that experience was I remember hearing a voice. And I knew that voice was God, but I didn't know how to, as a kid, I didn't know how to take it all in. And so to this day, I you know, some people, they have those similar experiences and they can tell you exactly what they heard God tell them. I can't tell you specifically, but I know that God called me at that moment. And since then, I've watched videos on YouTube and even at age 16, which I'm going to skip from 6 to 16.
Okay.
When I was age 16, there was I was sitting there at my mom's home watching television, and there was a talk show. They had a near-death experience show, and I'm listening to these people tell their near-death experiences, and I remember a lady telling her experience, and first thing she said was that she appeared in this place. She said they were swaying grass. She talked about the pretty blue sky, all the same things that I experienced in that experience I had as a child. And I remember, you know, laying there on my mother's couch, wiping my eyes. I'm like, you know, crying. I'm like, why am I crying? You know, and I had an epiphany. Apparently I died, or, you know, God brought me to a place to speak to me. Either way, it wasn't just a dream. It was a real experience that I had. So that's age 16. Soon after that, I really started feeling, you know, God pulling at my heartstrings. And I'll backtrack a little bit. I didn't grow up in a family where we didn't go to church all the time. My mom would go every once in a while, you know, maybe on Easter or you know, special occasion. And sometimes I would go with one of my aunts to church. But I wasn't an every Sunday type of person. So I didn't know much about church other than, you know, we went a few times a year. So 16, 17, I started looking at churches, and I had a friend that I worked with. He told me, you know, we were talking about it, and I told him I was looking for a church. He invited me to this church, and I went, and there were a nice amount of young people there. And at the time I was a young person. And so I joined and I started learning more about God and started growing my faith. But, you know, a year later I went to college. And like a lot of kids, went to college and lost the faith, right, and started partying and drinking and all of that craziness. And kind of did a little back and forth there for a year or so. And then decided around 18, 19-ish, I was like, I'm not going to play with God like that. You know, it's bad to say this, but, you know, I said, you know, I'm going to do what I want to do during this time. God, have mercy on me. That's kind of what's my attitude, you know. And so for a couple of years there, I lived life, you know, wild and reckless, you know. And during that time, I ended up gaining everything I thought I wanted during that time. You know, I had, you know, I got a car. I had a pretty girlfriend. I had had a crew of friends. I had all of this stuff. I had popularity on campus. And I felt the most emptiest, the most depressed I ever had felt. And I was like, you know, I thought I should be, you know, when I got to this place of having all that I thought I wanted at that time, I would be happy. Mm-hmm. And it was the opposite. Mm-hmm. I was the most unhappy I had ever been. And so I remember, you know, around age 21, a good friend of mine, and one of my first cousins' fiancés, she was killed in a car accident. And after her death, a bunch of our friends, they gave their lives to the Lord. And I just remember thinking, you know, I was like, God, I don't want to do it out of fear of dying. But I know it's something I should do. And I know that I'm at a place where I'm, you know, what I thought I wanted is not really what you wanted for me. And it's not fulfilling. And so I just remember, you know, a couple weeks after her death, praying by myself in a room, in my childhood room. And because I just felt like that it was like the Spirit of God was heavy on me that day. And I just remember just surrendering. I said, God, you know, I'm tired of doing this on my own. I know that I need you. I know that I can't do this on my own. So I surrender, God. Lord, I'm going to follow after you. I rededicate my life to you. Mm-hmm. I'm going to need your help. I can't do this on my own. And I still remember that was October or November of whatever year that was. I turned 21. So it had to be, gosh, 1999, I think. Wow. Yeah.
Well, and you've been walking with God since,
ever since.
Well, you know, what's amazing too is that, you know, even in our journeys, and they are never straight line. They go all over the map, and yet God pursues us. He's continually pursuing us, I'm happy to see how you are now living out your faith in a way that is. Not only being blessed, but being a blessing to others. And that's why I wanted you on our podcast and in part of this conversation, because one of the things I've heard is you've been such a blessing to the students in Fort Worth and others that you've connected with, that people love hearing your story, but they also find that your life is compelling and motivational, and you have an optimistic and hopeful outlook on life and looking to the future as to what we can become and what God can do in a life. And that's why you talk about those four F's. You talk about that those are areas in our life that God wants to work in and through. You know, so often, you know, you go through your training, Marco, as many physicians do. Of course, they're there to become excellent physicians, and same with dentists. They're there to be excellent in what they do, competent and confident. But we often don't talk about these other areas of life. And you're bringing really a holistic approach to understanding what is success look in these many other areas through a Christian world life view. So let's land there. Let's talk about that. And we won't talk about all these things because we're going to be limited in time. You talk about achieving success in these areas, these four F's. What would success look like? Paint me a picture of success in family. What does that look like?
So for me, success in general, it's not about perfection. And I right. think a lot of people think of success as imperfection. It's about progress in those areas, mm-hmm. and progressing towards what God created you to be in those areas. So as it pertains to family, you know, as a man, God created me to be the head of my family. He created me to be a provider. Created me to be a teacher in my family. And so if I'm doing those very things in my family, in my mind, not just me, anybody who's doing those things and are striving to be a better husband, father, or if you're single, you know, young single guy, but if you're doing those things, you know, you've been a priest, provider, protector of your home, and you have, you're following God's lead, following Christ's lead as he follows our God, Father in Heaven's lead, then to me, you know, you have success in family. Everything is aligned to what, like, it should be.
Stay with us. More Student Pulse podcast in just a moment. To learn more about CMDA, download our CMDA Student Life app. Available for Android and iPhone. The app will give you access to CMDA events, tools, Bible studies, and a wealth of other resources. Also, joining CMDA can be done on the app, and it only takes about 3 minutes to complete. As a student, CMDA will underwrite your membership so that you can join the community at no cost. Download the app today.
if you're aligned with God, with Christ, and you then the rest of your family should align. Not saying it'll be perfect, but you know, everything else should align, and it may take time, but there should be fruit of you being in alignment with God and being in your perspective roles.
Yeah. Yeah, being faithful to the roles and responsibilities that God's created us, whether it be in the role of a husband, a wife, son or daughter, it is being faithful in those roles and living out those roles to the glory of God.
Most definitely.
What about finances? What would success look like in finances?
Well, it's about becoming a billionaire, trillion. I'm kidding.
I was wondering if you're going to pass the plate on me here. Okay.
That's what the world sees success in finances.
Okay.
So for me, being successful in finances is being a good steward of whatever resources that God has given you. God is only going to give you what you can handle. And so the definition of success can't be defined by a number as it pertains to finances. But if you're a person who, you know, you may make only a certain amount of money, whether it be $25,000, $35,000, $50,000, $100,000 a year, whatever. If you are taking what you make or whatever resources are given to you, and you're basically doing right by them, you're taking care of the people you need to take care of. You're only spending what you can afford. You're not spending beyond your means. Mm-hmm. You're saving. You're investing. And you're thinking about the next generation, because the Bible talks about us leaving inheritance for our children's children. So if you're doing those things, then in my mind, you're successful in your finance. Mm. There's people that I know that make six figures and they still live paycheck to paycheck. Mm. There are people that I know that make way less than six figures, and over time they amass, wealth, they may contribute to their pension or to their retirement refund fund over time, and by the time they're 50, they have $1 million in the bank, or they own their home and have $1 million in the bank. But that person who made six figures, is broken in debt. Mm-hmm. So for me, it's not about how much you make; it's what you do with what you make.
Yeah, and it has a lot to do with the issue behind the issue. I think a heart of generosity too, right? A cultivating a heart of generosity,
most definitely.
Which goes well beyond finances. But if we're just looking at that narrow issue of finances, I mean, it's being a cheerful giver. It's generous and holding the things. I think you talked about stewardship, holding the things that we have in life with an open hand. And we want them to be used and God to be glorified through those, through a faithful stewardship of those things. So, it's pressing deeper still in oftentimes the heart issues behind the issue. You know, we can look at the external so often too, but what are the drivers? What are the idolatries? What are the things that we cling tightly to? Sometimes finances has a lot to do with control. Feeling comfort. It provides all of these things. Because we have money, we can rest at ease. We don't have to worry about things. Well, no, we still have to trust the Lord with all things.
And, yes, we do.
And in Deuteronomy, I'm reminded when he was talking about the going to the Promised Land to the Israelites, even after having come out of a very difficult, the enslavement, saying, listen, you're going to think all the things that you do are going to be built by your hands, because you're going to be tilling the ground, you're going to be raising the crops, but understand that I give you the ability, the health, the resources, the rain. I mean, everything is still a gift for me, and everything we have is a gift from God.
It's true.
Albeit he uses our professions and he uses the opportunities and the gifts he gives us to be able to earn those livings, but it's all from him. Yeah.
Yeah. Like I say, it's for his glory. It's been used for good, and I think a lot of times when people obtain finances, they think it's for them to store up, and you know the story about the person who stored up the treasures and then, they end up dying. You stored up all that money and you can't even you can't take it with you. Right. So, you know, what the Bible says, the rich are supposed to be able to readily distribute. And it's not, you know, the world, you have the flip side is that you have some people who will say it's evil to have money. Money is evil. Money, and the Bible never says that. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil, but money itself is not evil. And it's like you said, it's what you do with your finances. It's what God looks at.
Yeah. Well, good. Well, we could go on. I think there'd be great value in that. Unfortunately, we're going to have to cut our conversation at this point, Marco. I mean, it is, there's a lot on your website, I think people can go to visit, get resources, right? Information about?
Yes, most definitely. They can go to totalsuccess365.com.
Okay.
And then they'll be able to find out what we're doing. Like I said, we're in the infant stages, toddler stages of the business, so we're still kind of building and growing. Mm-hmm. But definitely, you know, check us out. And like you said, I'm available to speak to student groups. And I've done that through CMDA as well.
Yeah.
So just check out the website.
Yeah.
And I hope it's a blessing.
Sure. We'll put that link in the show notes. And yes to your availability to encourage and motivate and inspire medical and dental students as, you know, with your life story, your journey, and the things that God has gifted you. And Grant Hewitt, I think, made the introduction because I think Grant had met you through some of those encounters with some of the students there in Fort Worth. So
he did. And
go ahead.
Shout out to Grant. He's a great guy.
Be careful. His head is big enough already now. I'm just Grant, we're not going to edit that out. Okay, we're going to leave that in. No, he's a great guy. In fact, at the taping of this conversation, he is coming back from Israel with a team of 39 students with our Passages Israel tour. And I'm excited to hear more stories coming from that. That is an exciting opportunity. So very grateful for Grant and his work in ministry. So, well, Marco, this has been a great conversation. And I'm so glad that you're part of CMDA and excited about the work you're doing. And again, making yourself available to our student groups there in Fort Worth. And for all you do, you know, just thank you. And thanks for being a part of this conversation.
Thank you for having me. I take it as an honor. And God bless you.
All right, God bless.
Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time. CMDA's Student Pulse podcast is a production of the Christian Medical and Dental Associations. The opinions expressed by guests on this podcast are not necessarily endorsed by the organization. CMDA is non-partisan and does not endorse political parties or candidates for public office. The views expressed on Student Pulse podcast reflect judgments regarding principles and values held by CMDA and its members.